to be honest, I don't really know how this proof works. What I did forget to mention was the proof for this proposition. It basically goes by induction, where you take away the leaves of the tree, and that allows you to do very convenient Gaussian elimination on the intersection matrix, because the leaf only intersects one other component, so then we can get the rank down. And that allows you to do this. Now I wanted to do a little bit still that's a bit more sort of down to earth. So forget about the schemes for a second, or maybe a few minutes. And we'll just talk about graphs. So take G, comma E, a graph. And we say a labeling of gamma is an element of z to the power v. So we give every vertex some label from z. And so that's one part of the definition. And the second part, we define a map from zv to zv. And that will send a labeling to another one, where we label the vertex V according to its own old labeling, say, and the labeling of its neighbors. Yes. So maybe an example. I've got some. Let's label this 0, 2, 3, maybe 1. So if we apply, this is our gamma with some labeling. We apply delta gamma. So what do we get? We get some different labeling. So for this guy, I have just one edge. So I take 0 minus 1, so I get minus 1 here. For this I get 1 minus 0 is 1, plus 3 minus 0 is 3, plus 2, so I get 6. Yes. There I get 3 minus 2 is 1, and 0 minus 2 is minus 2, so I get minus 1. And here I get 3 minus 2, that's 1, and 3 minus 0 is 3, so I get 3 more.
No, it's 2 minus 3.
Minus.
So it's
4. 2 minus 3, oh, that is minus 1. And then I get 0 minus 3.
Minus 3?
Yeah, I get minus 4. Yes. Yes. Indeed. And now what you notice in the example is that if you sum up these numbers, you get 0. And also if you look at the formula, you'll see that should be the case, because it's all just in terms of the degrees of all these vertices. And of course you can also just put a constant labeling, so we get a complex zero close to z, close to z, v, z, close to 0, where this is just the constant labeling, and here we get this delta gamma is called the Laplacian operator, and here we get S of gamma, where S of gamma sends some f to some things. And it's a complex, but we just noticed. And obviously, if you get the constant labeling and you then do this Laplace operator, then all these are the same, so you get zero everywhere. So you can work all that out. It might not be exact there. It is exact there and there and there. So now going back to the schemes that we had, if we have X over S, like there, but also semi-stable, then this Laplacian operator is linear, so L, which is the matrix of this operator, equals the intersection matrix. So that is the matrix. There. And that should not be very difficult to prove, at least not with one of the definitions of the dual graph. And here we need the one with the multiple edges. I mistakenly thought that this intersection is always 0 or 1, but that may of course still be bigger. Right, so the ijth component, if you look at what that is, then for every edge you have to do a thing, and when you work it out you'll see that indeed it's this intersection number, and then you only have to do the diagonal components, and for that you notice that the intersection matrix, so the self-intersection of one of these components is minus the intersection with all the others by that thing that we saw right way at the beginning of the lecture, where we intersected with the complete special fiber and we found zero. So the columns and the rows have to sum to zero. So that's for the intersection matrix, and also for this matrix L, that should be easy to see. Because why was that? That was, oh yes, because the diagonal elements of this matrix are minus the degrees of that vertex that you're looking at. And therefore also the rows and columns have to sum to zero. And therefore the two matrices are completely the same. And now this looks, this complex here, or at least this bit, looks quite a lot like the complex we had before with the alphas and the betas, and we conclude that this component group is canonically isomorphic to the kernel of S gamma mod the image of the Laplacian operator. So you can do all of that just really in terms of the graph, and you can forget all the geometry. And that's where I would like to stop.
Thank you. perhaps we have time for a brief question or two?
So the proof of this theorem 969, that is purely graph theory? I mean, you could imagine if you are good in geometry, then you get, and if every graph comes from geometry, then you can maybe get something on graphs. But
I think the proof that BLR gives relies on the graph being a tree. It's they just give the example of the graph being a tree quite. So this example they give just before stating this theorem, I believe. But I don't really remember how the proof went.
But it is completely wrong if the graph is not a tree. That is completely obvious, right? Even for an elliptic curve with multiplicative reduction, that goes completely wrong. So,
from where I'm standing here right now, that's not super obvious.
Well, but this component group can be cyclic of any order, finite order.
This I n, okay.
Yeah. So that that means there is no bound M1.
Yes.
In that case.
Let's thank our speakers.